Okay, I hope everyone can see my screen. Just let Andrew know if you can't, I'll begin. So good afternoon and thank you for coming to this talk about discovering and accessing data and information from our catalogue at Geoscience Australia and a little bit about the effort behind making it work for us. I had intended this presentation for our local Dharma audience, so I hope that others joining us today find it and everybody finds it interesting. In this presentation, I'm mainly going to talk about the discovering and accessing of GA or Geoscience Australia's open data publications and the pieces of the puzzle that are required to bring it together from the minimum viable product we started with in 2016 and given the resources we have dedicated to keeping it humming along. Everything that I talk about today are the pieces of the puzzle that inform the work on our catalogue without really going into any technical details. So a quick background to Geoscience Australia and the data and information that it holds. So we are an Australian government entity of approximately 600 staff that came into being in 2001 when the Australian Surveying and Land Information Group merged with the Australian Geological Survey Organisation. Both of these organisations had their beginnings in the mid 1940s, which in turn were built off the work of the Australian Survey Office, which it started in 1910. So today, GA is responsible for meeting the Australian government's onshore and offshore geoscience requirements, including activities like resource development, natural hazard planning and resilience, groundwater research, carbon capture and storage, bathymetry, global positioning and earth observations from space, to name a few. We also have an education centre and would usually have at least three schools a day visiting during the school year. Makes it a very interesting building to work in. As you can see from the pictures I threw up, we have a mixture of digital and physical data collections, which are both modern and historical. Our current digital data holdings exceed 6 petabytes over various systems, with the data and publications delivering about 600 terabytes directly, which is about double due to a body of work around archiving. As with all Australian government organisations, we have legislative mandates, data policy and practices and expectations from geoscientific communities within Australia and also internationally. There's just a few up there. We did a small body of work in 2017 in an attempt to gauge how and where data went through the organisation before it came to us to be published. And this work gave us a good understanding of where our responsibilities, as in the publishing team, were under our data governance framework versus the science domains, which is the people actually doing the work in the building. We also confirmed a very high level view of the roles and responsibilities held by the executive and staff, which we're currently developing into a separate guidance document, work that's not for the catalogue, but is definitely required to make the catalogue work. My team is responsible for the downstream data and publications that are made available publicly or to the wider GA internally. This project's also pointed to where we should take a leading role with the catalogue into the future. So as you saw from the introduction, Geoscience Australia's got a variety of data types that it collects. I was in a meeting where the infrastructure architect was trying to get a handle on all the number of different data types and formats across GA, and I think they stopped counting after about 200. So this includes discrete and continuous data sets at different stages in processing. So far, all stylizing aside, it looks fairly straightforward on this sort of nice little squiggle that goes through our upstream through to downstream data and information products. I have to add that you know, this sort of mapping is no different in most science organisations, and wherever possible we are seeking to learn from others' experiences in data discovery and access. It's just an example of the different quantums we've got in different systems. So things 102 terabytes in our data store, as opposed to 300 gigabytes that might be delivered through an external national computational infrastructure, for example. So product publishing through the Data and Publications Catalogue is a well understood process, to the extent that most people at GA understand that they're meant to publish data and products through the catalogue before they make them available outside their project spaces, or outside GA. We're also confident that there should be more of an enterprise role over the data that's being brought into the building, and we've been working on a way to best capture and preserve that source data. What we have little visibility of or control over are the science project spaces, and support for that area is ongoing under data management and roles and responsibilities work rather than the catalogue, which is what this talk is focused on. We use the National Archives of Australia Digital Continuity 2020 policy as a basis to refresh the data governance framework in GA. And I was engaged in November 2016 purely to manage meeting that policy's milestones. The catalogue came under my wing about 18 months ago. As we all know from DAMA and DMBOK, a governance framework relies on several parts or pieces to be stood up and to function in an interrelated way. Data governance at GA had not been refreshed since 2012, and the governance framework had been unworkable as each part acted as a silo, or there may have been a couple of touch points depending on the people involved. And this is not to say that data management wasn't happening, it just was not very consistent. In the slide, the dark green committees and communities of practice highlighted here are the ones that directly support data and information governance, and if you like, it's my domain. We also have just published our second framework since 2016, and this is available through the catalogue. We have an internal version of this same document, and it contains hyperlinks to internally accessible content specifically for GA staff. The framework has the usual vision, principles, policies, and other enabling documents and functions to support meeting the vision. The Data and Publications Catalogue is a key piece that enables the vision. And when I did this slide, it's a great example of what happens when you check and proofread as much as possible, but still manage to easily find an error during a national presentation. So we discovered an extra L in easily up there. Governance is made up of many puzzle pieces, and our Data and Publications Catalogue workflow comprises of three main parts. So we have a policy that says, amongst other things, GA data and products will be made available through the catalogue with an accompanying metadata record. The second thing is a procedure that we call a product management plan, which is currently a digital/analogue document, and that's how we capture approvals. And the final part is the gatekeeper in the form of our corporate data manager, who confirms that the PMP or the product management plan and metadata are complete with the required approvals to publish. And this is critical, as the data and products are not ours. We don't understand them or know if they are complete or accurate. We just publish them. So with this process in place, the catalogue should be perfect. But this process has only been going strong since 2015. So there is an issue with legacy records created prior to this, and generally any record numbered less than 100,000 in the catalogue comes under that category. So finally, the catalogue. And when I say the catalogue, there are many pieces in that puzzle as well. The history of our open catalogue began in the late mid to late 90s as part of the Australian Government's Spatial Data Access and Pricing Policy, which required Australian government organisations to make spatial data available to the public free online and at marginal cost of transfer for packaged products, or at the full cost of transfer for a customised product. So that catalogue was administered on behalf of government by Geoscience Australia and was called the Australian Spatial Data Directory, or ASDD. So as you can see on my picture here, internally, Geoscience Australia has had a catalogue since 1995, and that was then named GeoCat. And from GeoCat, we did publish through the Australian Spatial Data Directory our external documents at that time. So the internal Oracle-based catalogue at GA was becoming difficult to maintain and search due to the exponential growth in data and products that it delivered, as well as just aging infrastructure. After a couple of hiccups, the current GeoNetwork based catalogue, which we refer to internally as ECAT, and that's the little cat diagram in the middle of the pointer, had to be stood up in a week with a team of two in 2016. So this was treated as a minimum viable product as our starting point. And we've been on a path of continual improvement since, drawing a line in the sand at that point, really. Improvement since has built with an increase in the size of the team managing it and assisting it both technically and socially. The current multidisciplinary team is comprised of a developer, a standards XML specialist, a part-time corporate data archaeologist slash publishing manager, a vocabulary slash publishing specialist, metadata quality officer, and myself as the data policy and governance lead. Only the developer, XML specialist, and the corporate data manager are fully dedicated to the catalogue, and the rest of the team provide support when required to complete another piece of the puzzle to make it work. The Data of Publications Search is the discovery and access portal for our catalogue of published data, data products and scientific publications, and this is the entry page. There are, and you can see it up the right here, there are 31,612 metadata records available publicly and more than 56,000 records in total. The metadata records are now compliant with the Australian Government's Metadata Standard for Geospatial Data and Information, which is fondly known as the AS/NZS 19115-12015. It's a really catchy title. The records are scoped predominantly by dataset, document, services and collections, but there are other codes available. On this landing page, you can already see two obvious metadata legacy issues that we have to contend with two lots of document scope codes, and yes, they are different sets. And the keywords, which have always been free text ever since GA had a catalogue, and you can see where that does cause issues in the long term. So this is an example of a splash page from a collection type record, and the downloads contained in the collection are over here under the downloads tab. So even though we have, I think I said 56,000 records in the catalogue, there are multiple objects associated with those records. This is a dataset record. It shows a good example of where we're trying to extend the catalogue metadata to allow us to programmatically trace provenance. So this is kind of new. So you can see the downloads tab, citation tab, the about tab, some technical information, and associations. So this is to do with provenance, that we're saying that this particular metadata record was derived from or is a subset of this main database, which you can also get to from the record. So the discovery and access of Geoscience Australia's data and publications are underpinned by the catalogue standard, which, as I mentioned before, is the 19115. The catalogue standard allows us to check conformance of the metadata programmatically. It also allows other catalogues to harvest from us and to know what they are consuming, as well as allowing domain experts to look specifically for data and publications that they need. I tried to make our future work look as simple as possible, but there really was no way to do that. So I've loosely grouped future requirements under tools, people, and technology. So we need to automate publishing process where we can. For example, we're currently developing a data publishing workflow, which will connect with our content management system and the catalogue to replace the current digital document product management plan, or PMP. We need to prioritise what data and publications we fund over the next 10 years and beyond. As the catalogue expands, there's an impact on discovery and access, increases in time trying to discover the correct data, the cost of storage, which is actually dropping really, preservation and delivery of some very large data sets has not to date been managed well over time, and all of this needs to be taken into account. So I guess the whole chestnut about the difference between backup and actually archiving something requires a lot more effort. So at the same time, we're repurposing the published product catalogue for our source data, aggregated data from outside Geoscience Australia, and archiving and preservation. And at the same time, we are undertaking a remediation exercise of the metadata records currently held in the catalogue, which I mentioned before are those records created approximately before 2015. And I think I could be I will be corrected, no doubt, but it's about 30,000 records that we're dealing with there. The remediation requires conformance with the standard, but more importantly, we're not the team that should change the metadata. The data custodians are required to do this since they are the subject matter experts and the data owners. This will also require training so that these people are aware and accept their roles and responsibilities in that space. The keyword and other vocabularies should be managed and be science domain specific, not a free-for-all. And sorry, that's my comment for free text. And to be honest, people really don't like having to create these keywords every single time, and they should be able to select terms from a well-known domain specific vocabulary. The web community is moving towards linked data technologies, and this involves having persistent and logical identifiers that take a user directly to the digital object, not just the metadata. And so there's the issue of managing that. At the same time, we might be producing updated products or superseding old ones. There are always new projects on the horizon that the catalogue will have to accommodate. For example, we have a large 4-year project finishing up soon called Exploring for the Future. And as part of their data portal, or the visualization portal, they've been harvesting information directly from the catalogue, which makes perfect sense. Create once and use many times. Except where you remember that there is a lot of remediation work required. At least, and the list for future work does go on, but I thought I'd just touch on those items that are currently on our immediate future. So I hope that I have shown the puzzle that makes up the GA Data and Publications Catalogue. We're working towards using procedures and tools to support user compliance with the metadata standard to enable a better search experience in the catalogue in the future, particularly by machine-to-machine purposes, although we are truly focused on the physical user. We're also using an iterative agile approach with the resources that we have to make sure that we don't end up with a piece of the puzzle that's not fit for purpose. So we do end up juggling a lot of things and we have to prioritise where we put our effort, but we try and make sure that we're always working towards a similar goal. It's a sometimes frustratingly slow and steady process, but I have to call out the excellent team that I have who work hard to make it come together in a way that supports GA, its staff, and the users of the catalogue. So that was relatively short and sweet. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for listening. And I guess back to Andrew, if there's any questions.
Well, I haven't been any come through just yet.
It's probably because I was too quick. Sorry.
Caught people off guard.
I know. It's one of those things where I'm sure everyone's aware when you do a presentation, you do one and you end up with about 50 slides and you go, no, that's way too much. And then, of course, I've gone too far the other way. So, but hopefully that's just kept that's it awesome. At the right.
So, turn off the screen.
Sorry, gave it back to you.
One question I have is around with the internationally. Mm-hmm. Is there a group, a special interest group or something managing geoscience sort of data on an international level?
It's not so much our information. I was just going to go back to there's definitely the standard that we use as an international community is the International Standards Organization or ISO 19115, so -3 that you can see, or you might not want to see, but in the XML up here, yeah. That's the actual implementation, and the -1 is the actual metadata elements. So that's definitely an international community that deals with that catalog metadata for spatial information. And part of the issue that we have is that we're taking a standard that was created for geomatic type information, and we're using it for all our data and publications. So that includes documents and the like. And generally it fits very well. We did an exercise 2009 with National Archives of Australia with their then AGLS standard for document information. And it was fine mapping from the 115 to the AGLS, not quite so granular coming back the other way. But so it's a pretty good hardy standard and it's been used for a long time.
Okay, so there's a couple of questions come through. So how many downloads per week do you get?
Oh, I should have had that at my fingertips. And I'm going to have a blank. I could go and find the information. It was approximately 500 gigabytes, I think. I'm trying to remember. Between 3 and 5 terabytes of information, not per week. That was over the last 2 months. So I do apologise. I don't have that on my fingertips, but it is. It really does depend on what information is downloaded, because obviously some of the data is bigger than others.
Okay. So is your DGF available online?
Data governance framework. Yes. yes. Yeah, no, that was, I'll just put the questions over there. So, if you have this link here, in fact, I could even probably try it live and see what happens. There we go. Ah, bingo. I love it when it works. So you just download it from there.
Okay.
So it's
very good.
There you go. My data manager's come up with it's anything up to 20,000 hits per month on the catalogue.
Okay, that must be Andrew.
Yeah, yes. Phew.
Good. So what are the metadata principles being followed when the data catalogue was developed?
Principles. So we... So following the standard, I guess I'm trying to think, the principles were that there are a minimum set of standards that, you know, mandatory standards, metadata elements that have to be used to comply with the standard. So the principles were that those would be completed for a well-described metadata record. And part of the work of we have an officer that's come on board for metadata quality, and part of what she's been doing is going into some of the older records and looking at, you know, what makes a complete and accurate record, because, you know, in this case the abstract for this one is very short. We can go to other other records where they've done War and Peace. It just, you know, they've done very long ones, so it we are looking for some principles around what makes, I hesitate to say 5-star, but what makes one record better than the other, given that we have a minimum amount of information that must be completed, and then what more can we include that will make it more understandable or more obvious to people what it is they're doing. For example, the scientists would prefer the citation to be on the main page, for example. That was just one thing that the scientists prefer. But we've kept the download link on top because most people just come looking for something that they want to download. I hope that answered the question. I'm happy for people to email questions through.
Okay. So just a comment, a question from David Weeb here. Mm-hmm. An awesome display of managed data practice. Congratulations. Practices. Congratulations. Would it help if standards were more tightly mandated, like through regulation?
So it's always a hard question. You know, most agencies that have the standards that they use would say yes, as long as it's our standard. So to be honest, the metadata standard that we use is mandated by the community. It was actually mandated by the Australian government, the old cross-jurisdictional CIO group many moons ago did say that it should be used. That, you know, as with all government things, these kind of wax and wane depending on who's in the room. But the ANZLIC Spatial Information Council, which has representatives from all the states and territories and New Zealand, they have agreed that this standard is the one that's to be used, and there's a community practice around that to try and encourage at least all the spatial organisations to make sure they're following it. It would really help if some of the general standards across government were more tightly mandated. So things like, you know, simple things like country codes, making sure everyone used, you know, the 3-digit instead of the 2-digit numbers, maybe the address standards that we have to make sure that information's held in a similar way so that when they start sharing it, that it's just easy to share one-to-one than, for example, someone to give an example in 5 different parts and someone else just to give a great big text string. It's it does get a bit difficult. So yes, it would be good if there was a bit more mandate on Australian government, but it's not so much the mandate, it's more the conformance. So, you know, how do people know that they're actually, or how do they know that maybe their third party provider is actually conforming with the standard? Because there's, you know, saying that your standard's compliant and being standards compliant, so that's kind of tricky.
Okay. There's another question here. How broad of a spectrum of data is included in science data?
I guess it's to say it does not include human resources information or financial information. We are focused on the science that is produced by Geoscience Australia. So the data that's collected, the products that are produced and publications, portals, software in terms of GitHub repositories and web services that are used to deliver data. So that we tend to focus on the business of Geoscience Australia as opposed to the corporate type information. We don't deliver corporate type information at all. That's held in their own systems and also our content management system internally.
Okay. There's a comment here from Andrew Marshall, which says the original catalogue created in 1995 contained very little information and fulfilled a basic need to deliver a limited range of products. Hence the poor state of a lot of the legacy record compared to current standards.
Yeah.
Okay. So do you have a how-to or introductory document or website to guide the user what type of data to find where and guide us on how to do an effective search?
Not, I'm just thinking what we do have. We have just the basic information. It's interesting actually, because we have a lot of videos help internally for people that are creating metadata and understanding, you know, the fields that they fill in and the impact that it has on the record. But we don't have something on this webpage, for example, to help people with that. So, nope, gone the wrong place. Here we go. Yeah, so that's a good idea. We'll have to have a think about that. We do try and help people by sorting their searches or faceting their searches slightly more. So that's possibly one thing we do. And educational products are very popular, so for the schools and things. So we do make it easier for them just to go in and search those particular products.
Okay. Has anybody got any more questions?
Can I respond to the one about the post office address file?
Yeah, that's, I don't know what the context is.
I'm curious about comparing that to the G-coded national address file. Again, it comes down to everyone should be using the post, you know, when you say that, I guess you have to say why, what's the purpose that they want to use it for. But I do get your point about one being more complete and using potentially box, PO box numbers and things like that. But it's, yeah, a bit difficult when I understand that's a proprietary product.
Okay, well, I think that's the, one more. So is it the idea of geoscience is providing access to some of its databases, data sets, can be used to understand something else better?
Generally, the people that use the catalogue, or when they're searching for data, they're usually domain specific. So it really isn't, I don't go into the catalogue searching for data because it's not my business to pull down a spatial, shapefile to put into my GIS ESRI system or something. That's not my job. So I don't use the catalogue that way. What might be an example of where GeoScience Australia does provide or try to provide access to people about the data is that we have this program, as I mentioned before, called Exploring for the Future. And in here, they talk about there are ways to use the data. Again, you would be expected to be understand the domain before you would open this tool up. They also have different personas, if you like, of people that might be trying to use the catalogue, or not the catalogue, sorry, in this case, the data portal. So I think this is probably a better example of where GeoScience Australia is providing access to its data, but also trying to give some understanding or more information about the data that it's providing. The catalogue really is a catalogue. Some of the information, so let's say if I pulled up some information out of here, just bear with me. I don't know, gosh knows what this is, but anyway, there it is. You go in here, you select this information. So a lot of this is coming directly out of the database. If you like, so all that information, again, you'd have to know, you'd have to be a domain expert to make sense of it, but this is more of a what's actually in the data as opposed to the catalogue, which just says we have a catalogue and here's where you can go and find information about it, I guess. I hope that was sort of a bit of a difference. So the portal is probably more where you'd go to find out the data that you can access out of the catalogue, whereas the catalogue is just what we have.
So what metrics do you use on the tool?
Which tool?
Don't know. The catalogue.
Sorry, I have to scroll down and see the. So if you're talking about the catalogue, we've got normal AWS type statistics, but we also we're moving to getting more statistics out of the actual tool itself. So we just did an upgrade recently, and on the back of that upgrade, we're introducing more statistics and dashboards so that we understand a bit more about who's getting the data. It's kind of tricky with the catalogue because about 10 years ago when people went to use the catalogue to download something, they had to register their email and they were sent a link to download the data. That was deemed as a blocker for users, so they stopped doing that. But of course, as soon as they stopped doing that, it reduced the statistics that we're able to get out of, the granularity of the statistics we're able to get about who's using our data and why. So we're looking at that conundrum at the moment too, to work out how we might get a bit more information about our users and how we can support them. So, I'm not sure of these questions.
So this one here from David, there's a map to where our valuable resources are.
Oh, the Exploring for the Future? I don't know about valuable resources, but that's definitely a map to where all the work has been done, gathering information about places, on mainly on Northern Australia. Obviously, Exploring for the Future was talking about this part of Australia, and a lot of this information is a combination of well, it's just new exploration that's been done in the over the last 3 years to fill in gaps. So there were areas of the continent that are very well known, and in previous years a lot of resource exploration was done, and then this project was just to try and go back in and fill the gaps, particularly in areas where scientists thought there might be more information. So, you know, more drilling, more boreholes, that sort of information. So a map to where our valuable resources are found. Not too sure about that, but definitely prospectivity, places where you might be more likely to go than others. Perhaps that's more what the information coming out of Exploring for the Future. Okay. So what tools being used for the data catalogue? So the data and products catalogue is based on GeoNetwork, which is an open source tool. And it's 19115 compliant.
All right, well, that's the last of the questions. So somebody's got a quick one to ask.
As I said before, if you want to shoot us an email, I have on the...
I'll send out tomorrow the slide deck and the link to the recording.
Yep.
I'll put Margie's email in that.
Okay.
Okay.
Good. Thank you very much.
So thanks, everybody. Just a reminder about the remaining Information Awareness Month events. So if you go to the website Information Awareness Month, you'll find all the information there. So thanks for attending. Thanks, Margie. And hope to talk to you again soon. Thanks a lot. Bye.
Okay, thank you. Bye.